नौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः ॐ आप्यायन्तु ममाङ्गानि वाक्प्राणश्चक्षुश्रोत्रमथो बलमिन्द्रियाणि च सर्वाणि सर्वं ब्रह्म उपनिषदं माहं ब्रह्म निराकुर्यां मा ब्रह्म निराकरोद निराकरणमस्त्व निराकरणं मेस्तु तदात्मनि निरतेय उपनिषत्सु धर्मास्ते मयि सन्तु ते मयि सन्तु ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः।
We'll chant part 4 of Kenopanishad.
Sa brahmeti ho vacha brahmano va etad vijaye mahi yadvamiti tato haiva vidanchakara brahmeti tasmad va ete deva atitarami vanyan devanyadagnir vayurindraste yenan nedishtham pasparshuste yenat prathamo vidanchakara brahmeti तस्माद् वा इन्द्रो तितरामि वान्यान् देवान् स येनन्नेदिष्ठम् पस्पर्श स येन प्रथमो विदाञ्चकार ब्रह्मेति तस्यैष आदेशो यदेतद्विद्युतो व्यद्युतदा इति न्यमेमिषदा इत्यधिदैवतम् अथाध्यात्मं यदेतद्गच्छतीव च मनोनेन चैतदुपस्मरत्यभीक्ष्णगो सङ्कल्पः तद्धतद्वनं नाम तद्वनमित्युपासितव्यं स य एतदेवं वेदाभिहैनगो सर्वाणि भूतानि संवाञ्छन्ति उपनिषदं भो ब्रूहीत्युक्तात उपनिषद् ब्राह्मीं वावत उपनिषदमब्रूमेति तस्यैतपोदमः कर्मेति प्रतिष्ठा वेदा सर्वाङ्गानि सत्यमायतनम् यो वा एतामेवं वेदापहत्य पाप्मानमनन्ते स्वर्गे लोके जेये प्रतितिष्ठति प्रतितिष्ठति।
सो इन द पार्ट 3 द स्टोरी वाज नरेटेड विथ अ डीप फिलोसॉफिकल मीनिंग। Agni and Vayu first went, tried to find out who the Yaksha was, the apparition was. They could not succeed and they came back. And then Indra went. Indra went and he was persevering there. And when he went to find out who that Yaksha was, the apparition, it disappeared from his sight. In that very place, Haimavati, daughter of Himalayas, Uma, in a very dazzling beauty, she appeared. To her, Indra poses the question, who that apparition was? And the answer to that comes now in the fourth part. Uma represents the Vedantic wisdom of Upanishads. It is rightly that she is daughter of Himalayas because the Upanishadic wisdom were discovered in the Himalayan jungles and valleys. And Indra's perseverance shows that one needs to approach this knowledge approach this pursuit with humility, and he is given the answer vicariously. It has been established before that the mind and intellect can also contact Brahman, but the mind and intellect is what is required to receive the knowledge of the self indirectly through the scriptures. So it is the combination of jnanam and bhakti that is going to reveal the Brahman to us. That is why you find throughout this Upanishad and in all Upanishads that upasana and the jnanam are always deliberated parallelly. The lakshya or the aim of Upanishad is to ultimately show the jnanam only. It is the ultimate jnanam, means the jnanam of the self-realization. But it is impossible to understand, practice and realize the self without the practice of bhakti or upasana. That is why both are revealed in the Upanishad. The combination of head and heart, when it is going to do the contemplation and finally when it culminates in meditation, that is what is going to open the gates of realization. So there is a pause at every stage, and the actual transformation from the waking state to the fourth state is something beyond cause and effect. So even in meditation, that you plunge into silence is the last practice that we can conceive of. What happens after that, we really do not know. So up till that, the pause is there, which is beautifully indicated by the answer coming in the fourth chapter. This is what we discussed. And then it goes on to give the Adesha in the fourth section here. We'll chant mantra 1.
सा ब्रह्मेति होवाच ब्रह्मणो वा एतद्विजये महीयध्वमिति ततो हैव विदाञ्चकार ब्रह्मेति सा ब्रह्मेति होवाच ब्रह्मणो वा एतद्विजये महीयध्वमिति ततो हैव विदाञ्चकार ब्रह्मेति
Brahman indeed, she said. Through Brahman's victory alone you have attained glory. Then alone he understood that indeed was Brahman. So Indra asked the question, who was that? So Uma reveals the answer here, that was Brahman. Brahman, the Supreme God. All the victories that you claim for yourself in the world are temporary in nature. The real victory is his victory. In fact, real victory is his victory in the sense that you can take it to any extreme. Whatever ultimately is his will, that will only happen in the world. See, Ravana was the greatest lord of the universe itself for some time. Hiranyakashipu was there. Various other devas and asuras, they could have been there. It is all a product of the fruit of their tapas. They have put in the effort to get that and they are having it. Just as the tapas, however big, is finite, the result of that is also finite. It can be even a crore years or a million years, but it is still finite. But ultimately, who conquers them or who wins over them is that ultimate truth only. Now, is it that throughout that period it is hiding or it is defeated? No, it is never defeated. Even as you conquer various success in the world, only if your will is aligned with that supreme will, that does that happen. If your will is not aligned with that supreme will, whatever is his will, that will only happen. Therefore, the victory in any form can be attributed only to Brahman. So here, of course, in the story, it was by the support of Brahman that the devas won the victory and they forgot it. And after every accomplishment of action, just as we say, I did it, the gods were celebrating it as their victory. Now here is, it's a very important point that Uma says, it is because of him, through Brahman's victory alone you have attained glory. Your glory is not because of you, it is because of Brahman, she says. Tato, tato, tataha, tataha means then. Then alone, he understood that indeed was Brahman. So when do we really understand it is Brahman? Then alone. Then alone means having understood that I am nothing. Having, after having completely understood and negated the little self, which is ego, only then can you understand Brahman. Here is a very subtle message. All the actions that we do, ego claims that I did it. I am the doer. I manifest as enjoyer and the doer. That is what the individuality is all about. But it is not you who are enjoying. It is not you who are doing it. This realization, when it comes, see, it is not even from the point of view of that you are a infinitesimal contributor, so therefore you cannot claim. That is correct. See, any action that you do, what is your contribution in it? No doubt you have contributed and it's apparent. But the fact that millions and millions of others have contributed to the one job that you have done, which is obviously your job, you claim it to be your job, but it is not possible for you to have done that job without the contributions of, we do not know, countless people. See, you say that you put up a factory. What is it that you have done? Okay, you have invested money, but the technology of how it is, the factory has to be planned and layout, various engineers, designers, architects, the science and technology behind the machines that are functioning there. The raw materials that, okay, everything is done, raw material is not there. What will you do? No, I'll pay money and get it. If the raw material is not available, what will you do with the money? Government, sanctions, roads, I mean, it is just, we cannot count. I mean, these are all very visible. There are various invisible factors. The workers, their intelligence, the technology that has come up to this point from time immemorial. So, if you count all those things, your contribution in the totality is next to nothing. Therefore, with that, you cannot really claim I am the doer, which is correct perspective. Therefore, this person becomes automatically very humble. But look at it from another angle. This ego that it claims that this is me, before you point out that this is me, you are already a changed person. It is very difficult to digest this, but science says the person who has entered this classroom and 1 hour later when you go out of this classroom, you are actually a changed person. Not at the mind and intellect level alone, even the body level, it is changing. Only thing, we are not able to sometimes perceive the change. When you see your photograph 5 years back, 10 years back, that very clear change is there, that is seen. But it is not once in 5 years we change. We change every moment. So, who is this I that you are pointing out to? It is like pointing out to the present time, which is now. You cannot say now. Now what is the time? What is the time? You say 9:22 and some seconds. Before you say 9:22 and some seconds, that is gone. So you can, I am told, I haven't used that service, that we previously telephone, there is a service by which you can call and find the time. So when you call, they say the time at the time of calling was so and so. Because you cannot say time now. Time now is so and so means it's already gone. So just as you cannot fix time, you cannot fix this individuality me. Before you fix, it's already changed. So actually, this person who claims to be himself is actually a very hazy figure. That when we understand, we have the least value for this gloated ego. Okay, this is philosophical, but at least practically, we have to understand that we are maybe one in orchestra. We are one spoke in the wheel, total wheel. So that spoke cannot claim any more importance than other spokes. What is to be given the credit is the hub of the wheel. The hub of the wheel is Supreme Brahman, into which everything else is connected. Therefore, after that, after you realize that, after your ego is dissolved, then only he realizes that it was Brahman. So here is a very subtle indication that unless otherwise the ego is completely annihilated, one cannot understand what this self is. Tato haiva vidanchakara brahmeti. Brahman indeed, she said, through Brahman's victory alone you have attained glory. Then alone he understood that indeed was Brahman. Mantra 2 and 3 taken together.
तस्माद् वा एते देवा अतितरामि वान्यान् देवान् यदग्निर्वायुरिन्द्रस्ते येनन्नेदिष्ठम् पस्पर्शुस्ते येन प्रथमो विदाञ्चकार ब्रह्मेति तस्माद् वा इन्द्रोऽतितरामि वान्यान् देवान् स येनन्नेदिष्ठम् पस्पर्श स येन प्रथमो विदाञ्चकार ब्रह्मेति तस्माद् वा एते देवा अतितरामि वान्यान् देवान् यदग्निर्वायुरिन्द्रस्ते येनन्नेदिष्ठम् पस्पर्शुस्ते येन प्रथमो विदाञ्चकार ब्रह्मेति तस्माद् वा इन्द्रोऽतितरामि वान्यान् देवान् स येनन्नेदिष्ठम् पस्पर्श स येन प्रथमो विदाञ्चकार ब्रह्मेति
देयरफोर वेरिली दीस् गॉड्स अग्नि वायु इंद्र ईवन एक्सेल अदर गॉड्स फॉर दे इंडीड अप्रोच्ड this nearest. Thus they indeed were the first to know Brahman. Therefore verily Indra excels other gods for he approached this nearest. Thus he indeed was the first to know Brahman. This is just a conclusion. This two mantras talk about the three types of worship in general. All the gods here in this context represent mundane activities of the world. A person who is pursuing wealth for its sake, knowledge for its sake, power, victory, success, various objects and beings and glories that we seek in this world are represented by gods in general. See, even those who are using some spiritual method but their focus is mundane has to be classified this way. So, in this context, all the gods represent mundane worldly activities which have no spiritual significance. That means the approach of the person is purely materialistic in nature. This can be pertaining to this world or the future world of enjoyments, if you can accommodate heaven and all types of heavens that are there. These are all represented by the gods. But among those gods, these three gods were little different. The three gods, as said in that story, Agni, Vayu and Indra. How they are different is that they were just not just caught up in that celebration. They were also wanting to know who that apparition is. Therefore, they are in pursuit of the self. That means this is the percentage or this is the proportion amongst all of us in the world who really wants to pursue Brahman or who really wants to pursue the self is a very small percentage. The verse that we chanted just now, Chapter 7, verse 3, that's what it says. Krishna says, amongst thousands of men, scarce one strives to know me. Even to pursue it's one in a thousand, he says. But among who strive, only one in a thousand really know me in essence. Attempting to know itself is a very great thing. But amongst that who really knows me, therefore the real percentage goes to one in a million, something like that. But as far as the effort is concerned, we need not worry when it will give results, but start putting the effort earnestly whenever, wherever you are, irrespective of your physical age, capability, etc., etc. Forget all those things, because according to the law of cause and effect, every effort that you put at the physical or mental level, it will not go waste. If it does not yield fruits perceptibly in this janma, it will carry forward to the next janma. That is how it works. So instead of just whining and wasting away the time, we should start putting in effort. When we start putting in effort, the first thing that we can do or that will be easily done is mechanical rituals, karma. That is why it needs to be inculcated in the childhood. No doubt at that point of time we may not know the meaning. Later there will be chance for you to inquire and know the meaning. But still performing rituals is valuable. It has its own value. Here you can even expand it to karma yoga. What we do as rituals, even going to office is a ritual now. So at least those things you can convert it into worship. That is, I am talking at a little lower level. But ideally you have to do karma with reference to what is sanctioned in the scriptures, etc., in that spirit. So in that spirit, if you can do other karma yoga also, it is acceptable. When we start our spiritual journey, what has to be dealt with is the bulk of vasanas that we are caught up in. What is spirituality? Spirituality is to take your mind and intellect in the flight towards Brahman. Now, if the flight is overloaded with weight, it cannot take off. So therefore, it needs to be offloaded. The weight has to be removed. The weight of our vasanas, the weight of our desires is what is actually making us not take off. Therefore, in the beginning, karma yoga is sanctioned. It is a very direct method, easy method, and there is no fear in this method. No fear in the sense, what will happen, what if I fail, all those things really doesn't matter here. Because if you take up suddenly meditation, renunciation, etc., that requires a lot of discipline. If you fail there, the fall is precipitous there, but in karma yoga that is not there. And also there are no contrary results here. There is no side effects for this. It is only a win-win situation as far as karma yoga is concerned. Therefore, one need to perform this. Now, people may ask, whole spirituality is about mind and intellect. How does karma affect it or affect it positively? Actually, it is by performance of constant rituals, it no doubt subtle controls the gross. Gross cannot control the subtle. Action is not going to make you give knowledge. It is not going to give you direct knowledge. But it makes things conducive for your emotions to develop further. See, think about a person who joins the army or whatever is the school before that, defense academy, for 4 years, 5 years, 3 years, he is supposed to go through various drills and exercises there. From outside point of view, it is a mechanical ritual. From the uniform that he wears, from the type of haircut that he has to maintain, to saluting the flag, to march past, to drills, to running, jogging and other exercises, plus some sessions. What he does this for 3-4 years continuously, ultimately when he comes out of it, he is a changed person. Not just physically, he has done physical exercises, but it is just not physical change that he undergoes. He undergoes a transformation at the mind level also. A sense of patriotism is there, instilled in him through all these things. When a person salutes the flag daily, when a person sings national anthem daily, when a person is infused with this, of course knowledge is also there, but these rituals also are complementary to them. So when a person does this on a regular basis, there is some sort of a change that can be done. This is a mind purification. Like that, the mechanical rituals that we are supposed to do will purify our mind. How it is really, see, that's why sometimes don't go by the strict logic of what it is. I mean, there is a logic and science behind it, but you don't inquire too much into it. If a person is able to wash his own plate, clean his own room, once in a while at least, it will clean his heart. But it may be very easy to question, how does grass cleaning outside clean my thing inside? The point is, when you are aware of the dirt outside and you are cleaning it outside, what is triggered is awareness. So once that awareness for the external dirt is triggered, it is automatic that you will be now aware of finer dirts inside. So therefore, external mechanical rituals has a great place in your spiritual sadhana. Therefore, to say your naam, Ram Ram naam or something like that, or you write something, these may be seemingly mechanical, but it does play a role. It does have a value. The rituals that you do, the festivals that you observe, or daily you light a lamp, or daily some 5 minutes prayer that you do, everything has a place in our spiritual life. And this is the starting point. This is the first stage, and obviously you have to graduate higher up. It's not that we study the school and again study in the same school only. You have to graduate and go up. So after Agni, which represents this ritualistic aspect and the Karma Yoga, comes Vayu. Vayu, who is representative of prana, which includes organs of perception, is slightly subtler. It is talking about subjective worship. So worshipping through karma, so in the first phase what happens, karma is the main, of which bhakti and other things are complementary or anga or part of it. Then at a later stage, your objective worship, which is to do with more, let us say, you may be absorbed in some type of worship. It can be in terms of your eyes and ears, absorption. Not more of expression, but more of absorption. For which karma will be anga, for which karma will be a part. See, when you take prayer as a main theme here, going to temple is a part of it, or participating in some small karma which involves that will be a part of it, but the main thing that you do is the upasana. Where here, in terms of perception, the upasana is about understanding the Supreme Self with a form. So you can do puja with anything as your idol. The idol or the murti here represents the ideal here. Ideal, which is the self. But we are not able to conceive the self directly. Therefore, we need a prop or something to worship. So these are all represented by Vayu, which is tending to worship the self with our organs of perception. Organs of perception are subtler than organs of action. So in the chronology, the first one is Agni, the next one is Vayu. But best of these three is Indra. Indra here represents the mind and intellect. So in the mind and intellect, the worship becomes totally subjective in nature. He is in a totally introverted state where he is able to focus his mind upon the self without any prop. This can be equated to Nirguna Upasana. That's how Swamiji has given commentary in the book also. Nirguna Upasana is to ultimately use all the earlier forms of worship to find out the self within you. That is the highest form. This is the direct method. This is the fastest method. But we may be cautioned not to plunge into it directly. It is a step-by-step process. Therefore, if you have any doubt as to where we stand and what is our spiritual process from where we are, take risk. You can always err on the right side and do karma. Once you obviously graduate up to a point, you will automatically take to higher practices. So once you do upasana, bhakti, etc., then the thing becomes conducive for you to contemplate. So therefore, then Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasana as given in the Upanishads become easy. Study of the scriptures. So that is where Upanishad reveals the self to you. So the karma is equated to first the hard work or preparation of plowing the field. That is the very bulky work, hard work. In that field which is plowed, which is where the soil is mixed properly, what you do next is watering the field. You make the field conducive. Watering the field is important, and then that soil you sow the seed. Then the plant grows. This is the way. You cannot directly take a seed and plant it in this thing. It's not possible. So plowing the field is equivalent to Karma Yoga. Watering the field is equivalent to devotion of the mind, Bhakti Yoga. Planting the seed there is equivalent to Jnana Yoga. This is the process that is given. And of these three, so therefore they say these three gods least try to approach the Brahman. So therefore, definitely they are far better. So therefore, compared to all the extroverted people in the world who have no clue of spirituality or who do have not turned towards God in any form or in any way, compared to them, those who perform mechanical rituals and those who are doing some sort of puja, etc., they are far, far superior. Compared to them, obviously, those who do subjective worship is subtler and superior. Compared to these two is one who is able to do introverted worship. He is definitely the best among the three. And by the sustained practice, he is able to then bring his mind to a steady way. In that steady mind, when it is applied into meditation, he is able to realize the self. Therefore, amongst all gods, these three are considered great. And amongst these three gods, Indra is considered the greatest. Yeah.
But it is said that just by doing mechanical rituals, it is not possible to benefit much, in the sense that you have to apply your some amount of knowledge in that. Now, isn't it controversial to just what we said in the first part in the beginning, that just do mechanical rituals and...
No. It is not said that mechanical ritual is going to reveal the self to you. Karma is opposed to knowledge. Rituals here indicate a refined type of action. The action that people do in pursuit of wealth and other actions that they do is also action. That is not going to yield them any result, except it will take them to a dead end and resulting in agitations in the world. These mechanical rituals, that's why we explained as to what is the connection. Mechanical rituals does not stop with the rituals alone. It really does something to your mind. See, a mother who has a newborn baby, and she has to take care of it at every stage, feeding or taking care of its all other activities. And so the amount of process that if you want to put it through in a piece of paper, it will be very long. Even a small thing like how to feed it with a feeding bottle, or how to clean that feeding bottle itself with removing that nipples and going through boiling water or sterilizer, various things that you do. The moment you see a manual and try to do it, it becomes very difficult. But after a while, it becomes a very habitual practice for her. Very mechanically she does. But all these things, what she does, it may be first very difficult or irritating also, if she has not, obviously she has not done before, it's a new thing. But it is for the sake of developing an intense love for the child. Now, no doubt it is the love for the child itself that will make her do. Okay, there is a trigger there. But by doing this more and more and feeling it, it also develops the love for the child. Therefore, like that, when you are asked to do rituals, you put water this way, left side, right side, or put the sacred thread. And it sometimes, whenever the priest says too much, it becomes even, why he is saying too much? What is the significance? We get irritated. But once you do and little bit, then try to understand the meaning, then you do it with bhavana, etc., it really purifies the heart and take you more towards the self. Therefore, that is the way rituals, per se, any action cannot reveal the self, that is clear. But these type of things which are associated with some meaning, but as of now you don't know the meaning, the emotions that are connecting in between will take you towards nearer to the meaning. But it is ultimately the knowledge that is going to reveal the self. It is only a preparatory step here. Therefore, verily these gods, Agni, Vayu, Indra, even excel other gods, for they indeed approached this nearest. Thus, they indeed were the first to know Brahman. Therefore, verily Indra excels other gods, for he approached this nearest. Thus, he indeed was the first to know Brahman. Mantra 4 and 5 taken together.
तस्यैष आदेशो यदेतद्विद्युतो व्यद्युतदा इति न्यमेमिषदा इत्यधिदैवतम् अथाध्यात्मं यदेतद्गच्छतीव च मनोनेन चैतदुपस्मरत्यभीक्ष्णगो सङ्कल्पः तस्यैष आदेशो यदेतद्विद्युतो व्यद्युतदा इति न्यमेमिषदा इत्यधिदैवतम् अथाध्यात्मं यदेतद् गच्छति वच मनोनेन चैतदुपस्मरत्यभीक्ष्णगो संकल्पः.
This is its analogy. That which is like the flash of lightning, lo. That which is like the blinking of eyes, lo. Thus the cosmos. Now as regards oneself, that is, as the mind constantly entertains thoughts, so does it go to this. This, he says, is Adesha. Adesha means order. Adesha means instructions. As we said, instructions are given in the fourth part of the Upanishad. The first part of the Upanishad declares the truth. The second part of the Upanishad explains the truth. The third part of the Upanishad gives the path to the truth. The fourth part of the Upanishad gives instructions. In general, this is the construction. This is according to the level of the students that the Upanishad is catering to, the master is catering to. For he will not want to waste the time of a fully prepared student. And for him, even the declaration of truth and the contemplation of that is enough. For others at various levels, at their respective levels, it has to be catered to, and then they grow from their level to the higher levels and they reach. So for a person who is at a lower level, Adesha or instructions are given. He is giving instructions in the sense, later he is going to give direct practices also. Because Upasana, everything is given so far. It is up to you to take it up and do it, which is tough. That is why he is asking further paths, and these instructions are given. Here, this is what it is, Brahman, I am telling you. You know, that sort of Adesha is given. Compare this with what is given in the first chapter, which is Shrotrasya Shrotram Manaso Manoyat. That requires a deep study, contemplation and understanding as to what is the real eye, what is the real ear that is going to lead us to Brahman. Or the statements like Anyat Yeva Tat Vidita Dado Avidita Dadi. The quintessence of all philosophy is given in that. Here Brahman is said as, I am telling you this, listen to this carefully, this order. It is the lightning, it is the blinking of the eye, it is there. And as far as yourself is concerned, it's your mind. That's all. This said. So what is the significance? What is it that you can make out of this? It has explanations at various levels. Please, these analogies that are given also has a deep meaning. But first it has to be taken as mere instructions, orders. So when something is said to be lightning and to be blinking of the eye, what does it mean?
Speed.
Distance.
No.
External world.
Macro and micro.
Far and near.
Far and near, okay.
Very difficult to notice.
It is very difficult to notice. That comes under the explanation. It is a flash, yes. Far and near indicates that
outside and
what is outside or inside?
Inside is the next one, mind.
Mind.
So, in the outside, the farthest that you can think of or you can see is lightning. So, it is as though God's world, you know, there. Lightning is there. It is very powerful and it is there. And your external world starts with your eye. Your eye, when you open, only then you see the world. So the world starts here, external world starts here, and it as though ends in a lightning. That is also Brahman. This is also Brahman, means everything in between is also Brahman. That is the meaning. Therefore, what it means is that which is all pervading in this universe is Brahman. That is the thing. So instead of working out like this, see the lightning, that flash is Brahman. See the blinking of your own eye, it is Brahman. And then he goes on to say, Adhyatmam. Adhyatma means inside. Inside what you see is mind. That mind is also Brahman. Therefore, inside you, outside you, everything that you feel, everything that you experience is nothing but Brahman alone. This is a very direct message that he is giving. What you see outside is bracketed between your blinking and the lightning. So that is completely there. And then what is inside is completely covered by this term mind. It is mind, obviously. So that is also completely covered. So is there anything apart from this that you can think of in terms of space? It's not possible. So therefore, that all pervading Brahman is that which is inside, outside, everything. This is a direct meaning, and this is the direct Adesha. That's how it should be understood. But it has also got some little bit deeper significance for us to contemplate about. This covers the three areas of our experience. We say the, we explained this in when we talked about the Shanti Mantra. We say three Shantis. One Shanti is for Adi Daivikam, and second Shanti is for Adi Bhautikam, and third Shanti is for Adhyatmikam. Adhyatmikam is inside you, Adi Bhautikam is elemental outside you, and Adi Daivikam is cosmic, which is very far off, which is, I mean, which is extremely infinite in nature outside. So all these three are covered here. This Brahman, when it is compared to a lightning, what is it that it is signifying? What is the nature of a lightning?
Flash.
Instantaneous. It is a flash. It is a flash. Especially in a dark night, when there is a lightning, before the lightning there is pitch darkness. For a moment it gives a flash. Actually, if you imagine, I mean, you would have experienced, but at least imagine if you are walking on a road which is deserted, or in a field in a night alone, and suddenly there is this lightning. For a moment only, for a second it is there, and then it goes away. Again you are plunged into great darkness. But for a moment, what you see is not great movements or anything. It was like a camera flash. In that camera flash, you saw a still picture of the world. Imagine if that lightning was for a second like this, or even less than a second. Of course, lightning does come for a longer time sometimes, but I'm just saying, if you are seeing that flash for a moment, for a second, what you see is a sort of a arrested world. Otherwise, which is not visible for you, there is an arrested world for a moment that you see. Now, this is exactly what happens in and through our experiences of this world. It is indicated by this lightning. We have drawn this diagram before in the part 2, but this part in the commentary it is given now that you take this x-axis to be consciousness, and all the experiences that you go through is indicated by this curve. So every crest and every trough is a high and low experience. Now, in between these two experiences, you actually hit the consciousness every time. It is not possible to grasp this because the experiences are so continuous. Like a compare the photograph that you see for a moment where it is arrested to a movie which is continuously flowing. When the movie is continuously in the motion, you don't see any break. It gives a solidarity. Therefore, what you see is the movie. There is no screen in between that you see, but It is through the screen that every frame passes through. If you have that, let us say that eyes, if you are blessed with that eyes, that if you can arrest everything and see, you know, the vision that we have and the vision that the, let us say, an insect has is different. Have you ever noticed, you can always catch a mosquito. It is very difficult to catch a fly. Why? The eyes of the fly is very tricky. The eyes, compound eyes, as she says. Suppose you see a mosquito and you catch like this. The mosquito is not, eyesight is not fast enough to register your hands coming. And then it is not reacting enough. So it can be caught. But it is in one motion that your hand comes like this. You know how the housefly sees it? Like this. Like now how a 1 second shot of a camera can be expanded to 40 seconds of slow motion. If yesterday I just saw a 1 second video of a cheetah or leopard catching a bird. Bird is flying from there and it is, you saw the jumping and catching. It's a 1 second shot. They are showing it for 28-30 seconds. That much it can be expanded. Now if imagine if the real picture itself is of that speed, it is very easy to understand. So for you it seems a very, the fly is here, I do it very fast. It's very fast as far as you are concerned. For the fly it is very slow. It is very, it is because it is seeing very slowly frame by frame like this. So it can easily fly even as you come nearer to it. If suppose you have that type of eyesight where all other humans have normal their eyesight and you watch the movie, it will not be, you will be laughing where it will be a very serious thing. It is because what you see is something completely different. So actually between every frame you do have a chance to see the screen, but you actually in practical life don't. Like that it is, Atman actually flashes itself in and through our experiences like a lightning, it just flashing itself. But from darkness to darkness as though we fall immediately. It is for a flash. Before you could recognize it, it just hides itself and we are lost again in our world of ignorance. See, this is not just philosophically talking about seeing the consciousness in between the experiences. Actually the grace of the Lord of the universe, it is there for us. When I say us, common people who are doing normal activities in the world, it is there for you to notice at every moment in your life. The moment you are able to see one thing and if you are able to catch that, it is very great thing. But we just, the mind just deludes itself and continues to flow in the experience. Actually, divinity or miracle, it is happening every moment in this universe. Ramtirtha was asked, he was claiming himself to be God, right? Aham Brahmasmi, I am God is what he was claiming all the time. So with their limited intelligence, an American set of people, they said, if you are God, show us some miracles, because that is their relation to godliness. He very jokingly answered, Christ showed miracles and you crucified him. So I will not show miracles, he said. He was actually joking, but he says, can't you open your eyes and see my miracles everywhere? See that the earth and moon are placed in such a distance and they are in relation placed in such a way from the sun that they don't collide into each other but form a perfect harmonious motion. Who does this? It is I who am doing this. The same motion which I keep inside an atom between the electron and the proton and the neutron, however they function there. With that same power I am able to do that with reference to the totality, all the planets. If you are not able to see this, any amount of miracle I show will not convince you. It will not just convince you. So actually it is a miracle. Like that in your life, you turn back your pages and see the times at which certain things has come out. You cannot explain it with your own reason and logic. How it is delivered to you, how it is given to you. It is some powerful grace beyond our human effort which is always there, making it happen. Catch hold of that. From time to time, like lightning, it flashes upon us. It just comes and blesses us and it helps us. But our mind is too preoccupied with the world that we plunge into darkness again just before. So therefore, he is giving the lightning as an indication of how the Brahman manifests itself in the life of a person who is steeped in ignorance. The divinity does flash. Even when you are not able to recognize it, sometimes it is flashed like a lightning. Lightning is something you cannot miss. So for normally, see, that you know how a coconut tree which gives that tender coconut water, where it comes from, it is standing by the side of a drainage, and that water that comes out of that tender coconut, it is so pure in nature that you can directly inject into blood. What is this? Is it not a miracle? When you open a banana, peel the skin and you eat, we just relish the fruit. But even wherever it is there, how it is packed so nicely, it is so pure, you need not go to wash somewhere, you can eat it directly. Who has packed this? When a man shaves daily, standing in front of the mirror, that somebody is pushing the hair, whatever be the centimeter or millimeter here, that is done meticulously. Nails are growing meticulously. These are all whose actions? So these are all flashed. We clean miss it, but certain things are given in a way that you cannot miss. But then if you don't, or if you are not aware, again like lightning, after lightning we plunge back into darkness. So this lightning example reveals the sort of a life of a common person who is ignorant in the world, to whom flashes of divinity is provided from time to time. Then come to the blinking. Blinking also can be understood at various levels. As we said, blinking is the starting point of the world. So it is just outside you, everything is Brahman. When you open the eyes, what you see is Brahman. Just as the lightning showed the life of an ignorant person, blinking shows the experience or life of a realized person. Very interesting. See what happens in blinking. Like we said this, now we have the technology to expand 1 second to 40 seconds in the slow motion camera. If a person, what is blinking? Like this you do. Suppose if this blinking, what you do, is expanded in the same level of the video camera, how long it will be? In that same camera, you can be 20 seconds or something. You are actually closing the eyes, closing it, and then completely opening it. Therefore, I mean, technically speaking, is it not correct to say that you are actually shut off from the world, and then you are coming back alive into the world? This is what blinking is something we do all the time. When you do blinking all the time, actually what is happening? You are as though sleeping, meaning cut off from the world and coming back. But tell me, in practical sense, are we really cut off from the world? We are never cut off from the world. It is a continuous experience. Blinking is just like this. It is a natural motion of the eyelid. So, technically speaking, you are cut off from the world. You are completely closed in terms of you don't know what's happening in the world. This is, if you can miniaturize the time frame, but practically speaking, that doesn't happen. You are always aware, open, even as you blink for a moment. So, what does it mean? A person who is self-realized, in whose experience self is always there, we see him functioning in and through physical, mental, intellectual and other types of experiences in the world. So therefore, If you again close the time frame, he must have lost his touch with the divinity and functioning in the world. But really that doesn't happen. He is constantly in touch with divinity. He is never cut away from it. All the experiences or anubhuti of great masters who have reached that state reveal this. They may be talking to you, they may be lecturing, they may be eating, sleeping, whatever they are doing. All the experiences that they go through, as though they have fallen from their state of self-realization and be one among with us, is what we see from our limited perspective. But they have never ever lost their touch with divinity. It is a continuous state, continuous flow, not even flow you can say, it is a continuous being in that state. It is a continuous being in that state. So what happens, what is it, how is it they are able to interact with the world and be of sense? It is just like blinking. They will never miss their root, but they will be able to transact with this. Second aspect of blinking is that one indication, like breathing, that a man is alive is blinking, isn't it? Physically, a visible, perceptible symptom of life is blinking. Breath also you have to keep here and see, but blinking you can see. If the eyes don't open or the opened eyes don't close, that means he is gone. He is for all practical purposes, he is dead. So therefore, as long as this blinking happens, you are alive. Therefore, if you go into search of who is making this blinking happen, again you will hit the same consciousness which this Upanishad has described in the previous thing. So whenever you blink, that means it's the most natural sort of unconscious movement of the eyelids that we always do. But if you are able to bring in the consciousness towards this type of experience also, then you can never miss awareness in any of your experience. It is given as Adesha, that's very clear. We said in the beginning, Adesha means Brahman starts from eyelid and it is there up to this lighting. It is all Brahman, that is what it is. But it has a very deep meaning if you go per se as to why he has chosen these two. Blinking represents the deepest one of the experiences which we do unconsciously. The root cause of that is also the same Brahman. To remind us of that, this Nimisha. Nimisha means to blink, that is given. And then he goes on to say Adhyatmam. Adhyatmam means it is internal. In internal, Brahman is equated to mind. The functioning of the mind, if you are able to capture the essence of the mind, again it takes you back to the consciousness. Again, think about it. In terms of all pervading also, it can be understood. Wherever your eyes also can't go, wherever your ears also can't listen to that sound, your mind can go. It has that capacity. It will go travel everywhere and it is there. But when you go internally to find out who is this mind, we sent a video to all, you must have received, just a 10 minute clip on Ramana Maharshi. That's we saw it interesting and thought of sharing. Ramana Maharshi says, Manasam tu kim margane krite naiva manasam margaharjava. Manasam tu kim, but what is mind? What is mind? Who are you, mind? Like that you inquire and directly go in search of it inside. He says there's no mind. If you ask that question directly and straightforward to the mind withdraws itself to reveal that there is no mind. The existence of the mind is very strong inside us because of the support of the objects and beings outside. So mind exists with the support of objects and beings. The objects and beings exist because of the support of mind. It is a mutual coexistence which gives us solidarity. You forget for the world for a time being and turn towards the mind and find out who you are. It really doesn't exist. Where it is, how it has come from and how it is spinning a web and playing, it is amazing actually. So that mind, if you inquire inside, that is also nothing but Brahman alone. It is nothing but a manifestation of Brahman alone. So by giving these three beautiful analogies, that is mind at the internal level, eyelids blinking at the external level, lightning at the cosmic level, he has actually captured the entire Brahman in Adesha. So this is Adesha. This is just an order that he says here. This verse is for contemplation. Very many ideas and very many new things will come out of these verses.
Stilling the mind and no mind are same. Like when we talk about Bhagavad Gita chapter 2 verse 42 or something, we talk about that meditation drop and the mind becomes still. In the still mind, you realize. Talking about no mind, are they same? Or
no, in the still mind ultimately leads to no mind. See, stilling the mind is still a practice. Okay, it is like bringing the water as much possible of no disturbance. So it's crystal clear, and the film becomes thinner and thinner and thinner, but it is still there. It is as good as the entire light reflecting through it. But Amani Bhava or no mind is absolute breaking of the mind. So it is, you can say, one step before that is stilling the mind completely. So when people talk about in Ashtanga Yoga, Samadhi state, etc., it is a practice by which in meditation, finally, it is stilling of the mind. But what really happens, why it is different, we are saying is, up to this is a practice that is given. Even in meditations, plunging into silence is what we can ultimately do. But who takes that mind away? Who snaps the total thing away? That is not in our control. So that state is actual Nirvikalpa Samadhi. That is complete realization.
That no mind state is not in our control.
Not in our control.
The mind is in our
control. In our control. Up to that point, the sadhana goes, and silencing of the mind till that it is there. We have to practice the sadhana there.
Comparing this verse with Ishavasya Upanishad, third or fourth mantra, that on dure means it is far off, it's very close. Are the interpretation same or there is a different?
There is another and subtler interpretation to that also. This also is covered, but there is another also to it. When we come there, we'll see it.
To this, continuing what he is asking about still mind and the no mind. No mind is a state of self-realization.
Yes.
So, there is a sort of a no return from that state. In the still mind, there is it's closed there, but it is still, it can become unstill also again.
Yeah, it is possible. Technically, it is possible. That is why even those who have gained yoga through their self-practice, we see their stories, they fall, again they rise, etc. It is possible. But once the mind is snapped and the realization is achieved, it's a state of no return. Yes, sir.
Sir, that blinking part, can you also say that when you are in dream state or in deep sleep state, you're not really blinking. And when you are awake, you blink. So, in order to get Brahman, you have to reach a state of wakefulness.
You know, it's a good imagination, I would say, but it is a little bit far to stretch. But sometimes we can argue again and say in dream also, sometimes people do. Science talks about REM, right? Rapid eyelid movement or eye motion. So that need not be brought into the interview. It will be stretching too far, this mantra. It is talking about the blinking in the waking state only. And that experience is compared to the self-realized person's continuity in his state, basically. We'll conclude with the bhajans here.
Ananda Govinda Radhe Gopala Jayananda Mukunda Ananda Govinda.
शांति शांति शांति।